Hi, everybody, and welcome to Accounting with Confidence. I am going to talk today about what you need to know about 1099s. It's that time of year again, and everybody's looking forward to a new year, but with a new year comes a lot of reporting requirements, including the need to issue 1099s. So a little bit about me. I'm Beth. I am the QuickBooks guru. I'm a CPA located in St. Louis, Missouri, and I've been working in QuickBooks for over 20 years. I've been in the industry for about 25 years and own my own accounting firm. And so what I love doing is sharing my knowledge with other people, other bookkeepers, accountants, my clients, all of the above. So I really enjoy teaching people and look forward to sharing my information with you. So what is a 1099? Most people are somewhat familiar with them, maybe because they need to issue them because they're in a company that it's a requirement, or maybe you've received one. Maybe you have been an independent contractor before, or in business for yourself, or even received an interest or dividends on an account. So what a 1099 is typically it is used to report miscellaneous types of income, whether it be taxable or not taxable, depends on the type of form it is and what box the information is included in. So most of the 1099s that are issued and that people are relating to are used to report payments that are made to independent contractors, professional service providers, or other people that are providing services or labor to their company that are not employees. So income to employees is reported on a W-2 form at the end of the year, but if they're not a W-2, they may require to get a 1099. There's also 1099s that are used to report interest and dividends. So if you were to pay, you're paying a loan maybe to one of your shareholders and there's interest accruing on that, then if you paid more than $10 in interest, your company would be required to issue a 1099 INT for the interest. Or dividends, if you're a C corporation and you issue dividend payments to your shareholders before the end of the year, then you would be required to issue a 1099-DIV form. The other common area that people are required to issue a 1099 is for any rents that they pay to a non-corporate entity. And what I mean by that is if you're paying rent to your landlord and your landlord is an individual or a partnership, then you may be required to issue them a 1099 for the rent. And so that is a common expense that people are required to report, but not to those entities that are organized as a C corporation or an S corporation. So if you have a landlord that the name of the entity that you're paying ends with the abbreviation INC for Inc. or Incorporated, then those typically will not be required to receive a 1099. And just so you know, so a business is required to issue a 1099, but an individual is not. So maybe you're an individual and you own a rental property. You are not required to, as that individual owner, to issue a 1099 to anybody doing labor on that rental property. You don't need to issue one to your lawn care or repairs or any of those things. If the rental property is owned by you individually and is not held within an entity. So I often get that, you know, if an individual hires somebody maybe to help them around the house or to pay their bills personally or any of those things, those people do not need to get a 1099. This is typically a business entity who made the payment is the one who ends up needing to issue the 1099. And the purpose is so that entity that is receiving the 1099, whether it's an individual or a business, a sole proprietorship, a partnership, that's the IRS's way of tracking the income that that particular entity received, because there is not another easy way to track that necessarily. And so as much as I don't enjoy 1099s and the criteria relating to them, is kind of, it's not something you can tie back directly to anybody's income. It is what it is, and it is a requirement that the IRS has put in place. What's new for this year is, so the typical one forms that have been filed are 1099 miscellaneous, and up until this year, the payments for non-employee compensation, those people who are receiving payments for labor or services they provided, those were reported in box 7 of the 1099 miscellaneous up until this year. So this year, you may have two sets of 1099s or more, depending on your entity, that would need to be issued. There's the 1099 miscellaneous, and that's going to be all of your, if you paid royalties over $10, if you paid rent to somebody who's not incorporated for over $600, there's crop payments, attorney settlements, settlements being not part of the attorney fees, and a lot of other types of payments will go on your 1099 miscellaneous. And depending on how they're entered in the box depends on its taxability. And that is the recipient's responsibility to determine its taxability, not yours. You need to make sure you get it in the right box, but you are not giving them any type of tax advice or information on how that should be accounted for on their end. So the 1099 miscellaneous, it was the most common one, and it had a box 7 that was reporting all the non-employee compensation. Now that particular box has been split out in 2020 onto a new form, and that is the 1099 NEC, which stands for non-employee compensation. And it's that will be used for amounts that are over $600 to people who are not incorporated that you paid for services, labor, those types of things. And they're typically going to be due by January 31st. So the payments that are included in this is anything that you paid with cash or check and is not anything that you paid to these entities with a credit card. So that's an important thing to note, is that if you paid somebody using a credit card for services, you do not need to and should not include those on either the miscellaneous or the NEC form. So also included on the NEC will be your payments for attorney's fees. So you paid the attorney for professional services. It doesn't have anything to do with you splitting any type of a settlement or insurance or any of those things relating to any type of lawsuit. It is just for the fees. And the unique thing about the attorneys is that it is for amounts over $600, but it doesn't matter if they are incorporated or not, you need to issue it. So if they're a C or an S corp, you are still issuing a 1099 to the attorneys. Why the IRS is picking on the attorneys, I don't know. The other type of 1099s, there's lots, let me tell you, there are lots of 1099s, but the most common ones that you see, and you typically see these at the time that you are getting ready to prepare your personal tax return, those are the 1099 INTs, DIVs, and Rs. So the 1099 INTs and DIVs are used to report interest or dividends that are paid to an individual or other entity for an amount over $10 annually. So I talked about those before, that if you had a shareholder loan or shareholder dividends that were paid, then you would be issuing, your company would need to issue them a 1099. And then also, there's that 1099-R that we see a lot when we're doing individual returns, and that reports any distributions you may have gotten personally from your retirement accounts, and those are typically prepared by the administrator of your plan. So if you are not your plan's administrator, you are likely not going to have to be dealing anything in preparing a 1099-R. At times, you may be a recipient of a 1099-R, and again, how the 1099-R is filled out and what codes are selected and those types of things are going to indicate to you how it is taxable to you. So you want to be cognizant that it is prepared correctly, even if you're not the one preparing it. You want to review that. So in a previous episode, I talked about some things that we need to be looking at before year end. And here we are almost to year end. And one of those things that I said that you need to be doing is preparing to get your 1099s completed. So the first thing that you would want to be doing is you need to start reviewing your records for who may need a 1099 and making sure that you have the information that you need to actually get that 1099 prepared on time. So January 31st is the deadline for the 1099 NEC. And that means you need to have the person that you're sending it to needs to have received their copy, and you need to have filed them with the IRS or Social Security Administration, depending. I think it's the IRS, I believe. So you need to make sure you have that information because January 31st is going to come up very, very quickly. So you want to review your accounts, and I would suggest starting with accounts that may be called contract labor, subcontractor, rents, and look at any of the, and then also interest expense to make sure you're not paying anybody for things that may be a personal interest, such as a shareholder loan. And then you want to make sure that you have current W-9 information. And the W-9 is what gives the vendor the opportunity to indicate what type of entity they are, whether they're a sole proprietor, an LLC, a partnership, an S corporation, a regular corporation. So just receiving a W-9 from someone does not mean that they will have to receive a 1099 from you. The W-9 is their opportunity to give you the details. So you want to make sure that you have up-to-date W-9s. Red flags are when you issue a W-9 to somebody or you ask them to complete one and they don't want to. So if someone is refusing to complete a W-9, then you may have an issue later and you want to make sure that that you're not working with people who are refusing to have their income reported. So the other thing is if you are having someone prepare your 1099s for you, you want to get that information over to that preparer now. Don't wait until January, especially don't wait till January 30th when they're due on the 31st. Make sure you get it to them now so they can start processing this information through their system and be prepared to just drop in some final numbers and get those forms generated and issued for you as quickly as possible once the filing season begins. And then, you know, the last step for preparing for 1099s is to make a New Year's resolution that you will always get a W-9 before you pay a contractor. And I would suggest that you, so print out a bunch of them or create your PDF, and in January, before you pay a single contractor, send them a W-9 and get a W-9 updated for every vendor that is paid during the first quarter. You know, that would be a goal so that way, when it comes to your time to file your 2021 1099s, you are ready to go and you don't have to worry about getting the information after the fact. Because keep in mind, you know, you may work with a vendor in January and it may go over the required amount of $600 to be reported and you may not work with them again. And so by the time you're asking them for the information to file their 1099, it's been almost a year. And that becomes, you know, it becomes a burden to different vendors and to just getting the paperwork done. So make a resolution to get that W-9 ready and issue it to every single vendor that you can before you pay them in 2021. All right, so a couple other things that are going to make your life a little bit easier if you are either gathering the information for your 1099s to give to someone to prepare, or if you are going to prepare them yourself. We're going to look at some in-product demos relating to how to kind of set up your 1099s, and we're going to hop into the desktop version first. So here we are sitting in QuickBooks, and the main thing you need to do in order to start tracking information for vendors and getting them supported in your 1099 list is to actually make sure that you have set up their federal ID number or their employee ID number inside their vendor record. So I'm going to pick this computer services by DJ. So a lot of times that is absolutely going to be payments for services. So within the desktop version, when you come into their record, if you click on the tax settings, and you will be able to put in their tax ID number. And then there's a box that says vendor eligible for 1099. And you want to mark this. And when you do that, that means they will come up on your reports relating to 1099s. And I'm just clicking on the help button here to see the information that it actually brings up and gives you as far as information that you can then review in order to determine if someone needs a 1099. And of course, it's not popping up. But the general overall rule is that you're paying someone who is a contractor. You're paying for services, not for product. And you're paying them more than $600. You may not know if you're going to get over $600, so you may want to go ahead and mark this box. You've received a W-9 from them, so you can put in their tax ID number, and then you will be able to keep track of the total amount that is required to be reported on a 1099. Be cognizant of things like including in the amounts, things for expense reimbursements. Those are not 1099 reportable. It's only for the amount of labor, the amount of services provided, no product. So when you click on the help, you get this nice information about how to set up contractors and track them for 1099s. And again, right here, get them to fill out a W-9. That's going to save you a ton of time. So please, please, please make that a priority. All right, so if we put in let's put in a tax ID number for them. And click OK. Oops, didn't put in enough digits. Okay, there we go. All right, so that's the first thing. You're going to set up your vendor information. The next place that you will go to look at 1099 information is if you go up to vendors and slide down to print/e-file 1099s and go to your 1099 wizard. And this essentially is a system that allows you to file the forms, but it also gives you the information to map accounts for it to look at which accounts you're keeping track of that need to have 1099s issued. So it goes through your steps. You're going to select your vendors, verify your vendor information, map your accounts, review your vendor payments, confirm the 1099 miscellaneous entries, and choose a filing method, whether it's print or e-file. Keep in mind, if you are to print 1099s to be mailed to the IRS, you need to have original red copies that you are printing on. If you're going to e-file, you do not need to have those red copies. So that is still a unique thing that is required with the 1099s. Hopefully they will get rid of it soon, but who knows. In addition, take note here that they have not revised this to talk about the NEC yet, the non-employee compensation. It's still only referring to miscellaneous. I would expect there will be some updates from Intuit very soon. All right, so your first step is to come in and you're going to choose the different vendors. And here you can see computer services by DJ. I marked that they were eligible for 1099. And so it's here on my list. And then it is also showing what accounts have been used. And if there's more than one account that you've used, then it is showing multiple. So once you've reviewed your list, and you can continue to scroll down, and if there are other ones that you need to mark, you can. So here's one that's rent. You know, we might want to track that. So we're going to click continue. And here's where you're going to review any information relating to each of those vendors that you have selected. You're going to have phone numbers, address, their ID number is most important. And keep in mind that if it's an individual, you want to make sure it's a social security number that is listed here. And then the next piece is to look at your different accounts that you have in your chart of accounts and determine what accounts need to have 1099s reviewed, essentially. You're going to map. So your subcontractor account is a common one. And so typically, that would be non-employee compensation. And like I said, this is showing, you know, the box 7 of that 1099 miscellaneous. Just know that this will be updated prior to the the 1099 NECs becoming live and the filing season for 2020. But if you chose that anything that you are putting in subcontract, that's non-employee compensation. You know, if you have rent, you're going to put it in rent box. If you had professional services for, you know, legal or accounting, you're going to put those in non-employee compensation as well. And then finally, you're going to review. You can go in and view included payments, and you can find payments that might need to be excluded. And this is where you can exclude anything that was paid with a credit card. Okay, so if you're looking at your list and you see anything that shows that it was paid by a credit card, then you can, then it should be excluded from the list or the 1099 calculation. And then you will be able to, for a fee, I should say, choose who you need to file 1099s for and get them filed. So you'll be able to generate the 1096 form. You'll be able to, I believe you still are able, for a fee, to be able to actually file the forms electronically. So in here, there's lots of things in here, and if you follow all of their instructions, and I would wait until the update has come out to include the NEC information, you would be able to do your own 1099s. But if you were actually just, if you were having someone else prepare your 1099s, here's what I would do. I would make sure all of that got done. I had marked these people to be vendors in my client file, and I would take my 1099 summary report. And I think we're looking at a wrong year, probably. Let's see. Let's look at last year. Oops. Last, or this calendar year. There we go. All right, so we have this calendar year. I'm going to make this report bigger so everybody can see it a little bit better. And what you see here is the person who would be getting the 1099, you would see their ID number, and you would see what box you have said that it should go in. Now, if you were to provide this to your client or to your preparer, you could also include the detail list, which should include their addresses, and that becomes super helpful. What the preparer would do is compare it to the W-9, make sure that none of them are incorporated and therefore did not require to have a 1099. It will also only pull the information that matches the thresholds. The thresholds being, you know, at least $600 in payments. So there's lots of tools within QuickBooks to help you get the information you need in order to prepare the 1099s or help your preparer prepare the 1099s so that it would take less time and possibly cost you less. So let's hop over to QuickBooks online. And it's the same situation. Here I am in Computers by Jenny. And she is, if we determine that she needs a 1099, we're going to edit her vendor details. And here over on the right, we're going to say track payments for 1099. So in this screen, you can also put what expense account her payments typically default to, but marking this box is what is going to get the information to show up on any reports that you provide to your 1099 preparer. To actually work through the 1099 process within QuickBooks Online, when you're in your vendor's screen on the main screen, there's a button that says Prepare 1099s. Again, there is a fee if you were to have QuickBooks prepare your 1099s. They will not begin filing any of them until at least January 1st. But this is the same setup. You're going to make sure your company information is correct. And then you're going to come through and say, hey, I need to categorize my things. You know, I have non-employee compensation. Where should I tell QuickBooks to look for the non-employee compensation? Maybe I need them to look in my accounting because I pay an accountant, or my bookkeeper, and possibly legal fees. If I have legal, I have a lawyer, I have, maybe I pay people for installation. You know, so here all you're doing is picking the things that where you would expect people who you pay that need a 1099 to be found. And then rents, you would do the same thing. You would choose what account it should look for rent in. Oops. Let's see if I can get it. There we go. Okay. So you're going to come down here and you are going to choose rent. And it's already got some selected, rent or lease, promotions, permits. Yeah. So it's got, I'm not sure why you would have stationary chosen. There you go. All right. And then if you had other types of things that were required to have payments, crop insurance, fishing boat proceeds, royalties, QuickBooks Online and QuickBooks Desktop does not prepare a 1099 interest or DIV. So you will not, they will be handling miscellaneous and NEC only. So once you've mapped your accounts, you're going to review your contractor information. You're going to make sure you have all the information. And first thing it says is, hey, you marked this person that they need a 1099, but you didn't give me a tax ID. And you can come right in here and edit this once you receive the W-9 from her. And then you're going to make sure that you have, so online has already prepared for 1099 NECs. That's great. They're ahead of the game. I'm expecting updates to happen on the desktop version before the end of the year. But you're going to essentially have the ability to review your contractors, make sure you've got the total payments. You'll be able to see anything that's been excluded and what's going to be on the 1099 completely. So those are ideas of where in the software you can go to get the information to really kind of figure out what you need to send. I'm going to tell you that the biggest things is to get a W-9, and also to be aware of your filing deadlines. So that becomes super important because they have changed some of the deadlines, and it used to be that you could get an automatic extension. And you can't anymore. So the NEC deadline is January 31st. Because January 31st falls on a Sunday, your date is actually February 1st of 2021. The 1099 miscellaneous interest dividends, if you are paper filing, those are due on March 1st. But if you are e-filing, those are due on March 31st. So there's lots of deadlines to keep track of, and there's no automatic 30-day extension anymore. There is the ability to take an extension, but I honestly don't recommend it. If you start now in getting your W-9 information ready and you're reviewing your accounts, you only have a few more weeks left in the year, you're going to know who's going to go over the $600 limit. Get that information now, get it over to your preparer or get the information loaded into your QuickBooks file, and you will be ahead of the game and ready to get these filed on time by February 1st, March 1st, or March 31st. All right, everybody, here's some ways to stay connected with me. You can always find me on my Facebook page at WLXCo. And my website, which is www.wlxco.com. And if you ever have any questions, please feel free to email me, beth@wlxco.com. I will say good luck to you in getting your 1099s ready and prepared, and have a safe and happy year end.